Okay, so let's begin to seek the Lord for in prayer before we begin our study. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for bringing us here together at camp meeting, a week that we can set aside our worldly business and our secular affairs and the cares of this life, that we can focus on you, we can rest in you, that we can spend time with you. I pray that the blessing that you would have us to experience at camp meeting may be realized with each and every one of us. I pray that while we come here, we can have a desire to seek our Lord and Savior and a personal walk with Him closer than before we came here. Help us to lay aside our agendas, our plans, or any self-interest that we may have on these grounds. But I pray that our hearts may be subdued by the renewing Spirit of grace. And I pray that as we study your word, it will not be my words, it will not be the words of men or the theories of men, but I pray that the word of God may be exalted and Christ and him crucified may be known among all of us, that we may behold in him a divine Savior that can satisfy all of our needs. I pray that you will help us to find the steps to victory in our lives and our walk with you. In Jesus Christ's name, amen.
Amen.
As you can see on the handout, the title today is Steps to Victory. We're going to, by God's grace, be looking at a very practical study of what we go through in our everyday experience. When people rub us the wrong way, how do we react? We're going to be seeing daily struggles in the Christian walk. We are in a warfare as Christians, and so we are going to avail ourselves with the weapons that God has provided for us to find victory in these conflicts. So one thing that I would like, a principle I would like to share, if we can all turn to John chapter 8 and verse 31. John 8, 31. I'm going to read how the Word of God says we are going to be made free from our conflicts and trials in life, any besetment, any sin that entangles us in this life, how we can find freedom is found in this principle. Very simple, but life-changing and profound principle. In John chapter 8, verse 31, the Bible says, "Then said Jesus to the Jews which believed on him, If ye continue in my word, then are ye my disciples indeed. And ye shall know the what?
Truth.
The truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, We be Abraham's seed, and we were never in bondage to any man. How sayest thou, ye shall be made free? They're like, you know, we're not in bondage, we're free. How can you say that? In order for me to be made free, I need to be in bondage. What are you trying to say, Jesus? Jesus answered and said unto them, Verily, verily, I say unto you, Whosoever committeth sin is a servant to sin. We are in slavery as long as we are obeying and listening to the voice and policy of Lucifer. And he is a tyrant. But we want to know, how can we overcome and how can we have that victory that breaks those bonds of wickedness? The answer is by knowing the truth. So I want to share a principle that is found in this beautiful quote. It's from Review and Herald, June 10th, 1884. Here we find it tells us, when he sees a weakness in his character, it is not enough to confess it again and again. Have you ever fallen and you've confessed your sins, you've asked for forgiveness, but you find that you just keep again and again going through the same experience of rise and fall, and you're just wondering, why can I never get ahead? Why am I not making progress to find the precious victory that I really desire in this experience? This paragraph's gonna let us know. It is not enough to confess it again and again. He must go to work with determination and energy to overcome his defects. How? By building up opposite traits of character. Huh. He will not shun this work because it is difficult. Untiring energy is required of the Christian, but he is not obliged to work in his own strength. Divine power awaits his demand. Everyone who is sincerely striving for the victory over self will appropriate the promise, "My grace is sufficient for thee." The answer to overcoming and being free from sin is by studying the opposite traits of character. So often, when we fail, we look at our discouragement, we look at our hardship, our inability to obey, or it's like, oh no, I did it again. It's like, I'm always doing this, or there's a lot of self-pity that begins to rise up. But the answer is not looking at self, but it's by studying the opposite traits of the character that you are struggling with. What a concept. Study the opposite. This is how we can find victory over sin. And who was undefiled, holy, and sinless? Jesus Christ. So the way we're going to overcome every sin is by studying the opposite traits of character, the life and self-sacrificing love of Christ, his example, and seeing what he has done in these situations that we are personally struggling with. This is how we're going to overcome. Isaiah 26:3 gives us a promise many are familiar with, that will keep him in perfect peace whose mind is stayed on thee, because he trusteth in thee. If our minds are stayed on Christ, that's where we can have that great peace, have they that love thy law, and nothing shall offend them. And I want to share with you a testimony. Before I was a Christian, there was I gave my heart to Christ when I was 16, but before this, I was a pretty unruly child, and I wasn't the most easy person to get along with, to say the least. And I would say, at least in my household, the people I live with closely, one of the biggest struggles that we had in like growing up is that I just quite simply did not want to do the dishes, and I was pretty rebellious. And this may be pretty minor, but it's practical, and I want to share with you my experience, how God gave me victory over this. And this could be anything that we're struggling with, but for me, it happened to be doing dishes. I would rather clean the entire house than wash the sink of dishes. But this caused conflict and chaos in our house. But when I became a Christian, I was finding that Christ became my motivation to change. Christ became like this desire, this overwhelming, like this, his grace is sufficient for me. I found strength in my weakness and to make progress in different areas of my life. And I was thinking, it's like, all right, so dishes, I need to wash dishes. And I've been finding that Christ is giving me the strength over these things. Why can't he help me with dishes? So I figure, the only way I'm going to be able to overcome this, because it was deep-rooted in me, I had to study what the Word of God says about dishes. If I can acquaint myself or study the opposite traits of character, if I can study what the Word of God, the testimony of Jesus Christ has to say about washing dishes, and maybe I can find strength or the answers to overcome. And here were some of the verses that I found. If we can go to 2 Kings 21:13, this is just a few, and really I found like 30 or some odd verses that speak about washing dishes. Let's go to 2 Kings 21:13. You'd be amazed. God cares about every portion of our life. Even the things that we think are minor or insignificant or have no direct religious bearing, He has counsel in our life and how to be like Christ. 2 Kings 21:13. The Word of God says, I will stretch over Jerusalem the line of Samaria and plummet the house of Ahab, and I will wipe Jerusalem as a man wipeth a dish, wiping it and turning it upside down. Have you ever been washing the dishes and you're like, you know, you're washing a plate and you're like, we don't really eat on the bottom of the plate. Does it really need to be washed? And that question may come into your mind. It has in mine. But the Bible says, well, when God washes a dish, He turns it upside down. And so it's very practical. God's like, very straightforward. Here's another verse. Let's go to Matthew 23, verse 25. This is the woe to the scribes, Pharisees, hypocrites. In the very sermon that Christ was, with tears in His voice, giving His scathing rebukes, we find counsel on doing dishes. Matthew 23, 25 through 28. Matthew 23, 25, the Bible says, woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for you may clean the outside of the cup and of the platter, but within they are full of extortion and excess. Thou blind Pharisee, cleanse first that which is within the cup and platter, that the outside of them may be clean also. Woe unto you, scribes and Pharisees, hypocrites, for ye are like unto whited sepulchres, which indeed appear beautiful outward, but are within full of dead men's bones and of all uncleanliness. Even so ye also outwardly appear righteous unto men, but within ye are full of hypocrisy and iniquity. So we see in God, Jesus compared the work of the hypocrite as being a cup that is washed on one side and not on the other. While on the contrary, the opposite trait of character, God's work is represented as being very thorough, that He would wipe and turn it upside down. So doing the dishes in a haphazard way is the work of a hypocrite, and it shows what kind of character we are developing or portraying. So my point is, as I'm not going to preach about washing dishes up here, but I share these things to explain a part of my testimony that by studying the opposite traits of character, I was amazed to see what God had to say on such a basic subject that you generally wouldn't think God has counsel in. But God cares about us in every way, and He has strength to overcome. He has what we need to be able to find the steps to victory, and it's found in God's Word by studying the opposite traits of character. And a lot of this warfare that's going on between Christ and Satan, the great controversy, this great controversy is over your mind. It's over your thoughts and your feelings. This is what the devil is trying to claim and keep you captive. It's a state of mind. It's your feelings that are associated with these thoughts. If you can find victory over your thoughts and feelings, you can find victory over any sin. And it's only through divine strength, through Christ's help. So do you want to understand how to control your thoughts and feelings? No?
Yes.
Amen.
Okay. Then let's go to Hebrews chapter 5, verse 14. Hebrews 5:14 gives us a very encouraging principle that lets us know how victory is obtained. Hebrews 5:14. And we're not going to go over everything in our handout, and I'll just say that right now. So praise the Lord that we were able to come early to the first meeting, because you'll have a handout you can study when you go home and look into more detail. We're going to be It's here for your further study, but we won't go over everything. Hebrews 5:14. The Bible says, "But strong meat belongeth to them that are of full age, even those who by reason of use have their senses exercised to discern both good and evil." So here is a principle that by using we exercise. I love the word exercise because think about, it's very practical if you're in a gym or if someone has never exercised before, do you expect them to be able to bench press 200 pound weights? No. You don't expect them from not exercising to immediately, through the most trying circumstance, be able to find that victory, to be able to lift that much weight. First, they might start with 10 pounds and go to 25 pounds and 45 pounds. They exercise by reason of use, work up towards it. So likewise, the power of self-restraint strengthens by exercise. That which at first seems difficult, by constant repetition, grows easy until thoughts and actions become habitual.
Amen.
Now, let's see another thing that if we want to be able to master our thoughts and our feelings, we have to go to 1 Corinthians 9:25. 1 Corinthians 9:25. If we want to master our thoughts and our feelings, what must we be? This is a familiar verse with many. Everyone that striveth for mastery is what in all things?
Temperate.
Temperate in all things. If we want to master our thoughts, we got to be temperate in our seeing, temperate in our thinking, temperate in our eating. Temperance is part of the fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5:22 and 23. Temperance is a part of the Christian walk that many like to shun. But we're going to look a little bit more into temperance by God's grace later on. Temperance is one of the ways by exercising we will grow and it will strengthen and it will become easier to control our thoughts and our feelings. Now, our thoughts may be, I was asked one time that our thoughts are sometimes easier to control. And if I'm thinking about something, it's not as difficult to change that. But what about our feelings? It's like our feeling seems like that's something people just allow to run rampant. They're like, I can't control my feelings. I'm angry with that person, and there's nothing I can do about it. But if our thoughts and our feelings combined make up the moral character, and God would have me to control my feelings, how do I control my feelings? Let's go to Proverbs 23:7. How do we control our feelings? Proverbs 23:7. A wise man once said in Proverbs 23:7, "For as he thinketh in his heart, so is he. Eat and drink, saith he to thee, but his heart is not with thee." So as we think in our heart, so is he. If the thoughts are wrong, the feelings will be wrong. And the thoughts and the feelings combined make up the moral character. Which also tells us if our thoughts are right, then our feelings will be right. Do we see? We can dwell on some of the most objectionable points of a circumstance or a person's character, and our feelings will naturally be wrong. We're going to have ill feelings towards them if we're constantly thinking and recalling and remembering all the problems and issues and way they irritated us. It just, like, by reason of use, we are exercising our bad feelings towards them. And the more that we do that, the easier it gets. But just like any habit, from what I understand, it takes 27 days to break any habit, no matter how ingrained it's been. And what I really like about the word habit is that just as we can form bad habits, we can as easily form good habits. And once we take those steps, while at first it may be difficult, but each time you do it, it's easier and easier and easier until it's a habit of doing good. How beautiful is that? It's no longer a striving or as much of an effort, but it's a natural, habitual thing that you do. And it's like rewiring our brain and our life to do that which is good and to follow the character of Christ. I love that. Habits are not always our enemy, but if we create good habits, they can be our friends. Another tip that will help us when we're struggling with bad thoughts or bad feelings, a lot of times it is induced by fallen angels that have been expelled from heaven. And did you know that listening to godly music actually drives away the fallen angels? Yes? Do we have a proof text? Can we show this from the Bible? Let's go to 1 Samuel 16:23. Where do we see an example in the Word of God that godly music, heavenly music, has driven away evil spirits that may tempt our thoughts or influence our feelings or try and direct us down the wrong path? 1 Samuel 16:23. When we're tempted with bad thoughts and feelings, sing songs, listen to hymns, listen to scripture songs, fortify your minds with Bible truths. We have this story when the evil spirit was plaguing King Saul, David would come in playing his harps. And this is what it says. And it came to pass when the evil spirit from God was upon Saul, that David took an harp and played it with his hand, so Saul was refreshed and was well, and the evil spirit departed from him. Amazing. Ministry of Healing, page 256. Did you know song is a weapon that we can always use against discouragement as we thus open the heart to the sunlight of the Savior's presence? We shall have health and His blessing. I remember reading stories about, like in Fox's Book of Martyrs, even when people were being martyred and burned to death, they were able to sing all the way to the very end. It is something we can always use against discouragement. No one can take away our ability to sing songs. While we are discouraged or we're alone, we're with people. I was reading Desire of Ages and how Christ would often be working in the carpenter shop and people would be, I guess the conversation wasn't very godly or Christ-like. And he would begin to sing the Psalms of the Old Testament and these heavenly melodious hymns. And soon afterwards, everyone in the shop would begin singing with him. And it's such a beautiful experience. Did you know that the cross of Christ will be the science and the song of the redeemed throughout all eternity? In Christ glorified, they will behold Christ crucified. Forever, the cross of Christ is going to be our song. So why not start singing and claiming the promises today? It is through the efficiency of the cross which alone is going to help us in this life. So question, were our thoughts and our feelings given to us to be allowed to run riot and have its own way without any efforts of restraint or discipline?
No.
Not at all. We know this because 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 4, hint, hint, this is a scripture song. Some of you may know it. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 4 through 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 10. For though we walk in the flesh, we do not war after the flesh. For the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, but mighty through God to the pulling down of strongholds, casting down imaginations and every high thing that exalteth itself against the knowledge of God, and bringing into captivity every what?
Thought.
every thought to the obedience of Christ. So we have these mighty weapons. Song is a weapon. Prayer is a weapon. And many, a song is a prayer. And the Word of God is called the sword of the Spirit in Ephesians 6, right? We have scriptures, which scripture songs would be a weapon. Songs drives the tempter away. Song is one of the tools that God has given to us that we may overcome our thoughts and our feelings and be molded to have the mind of Christ. Philippians 2:5 says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." I would like to read a quote from Messages to Young People. I found this to be very helpful. Messages to Young People, page 92. There's two things that our feelings should be under the control of. It says, even your thoughts must be brought into subjection to the will of God, and your feelings under the control of what?
Reason
and religion. Our feelings need to be under the control of reason and religion. What is reason? Luke 5:22. But when Jesus perceived their thoughts, he answering said unto them, "What reason ye in your hearts?" Our reason is our thoughts, according to the scripture and proof text. But what is pure religion? Let's go to James chapter 1, verse 27. Our feelings need to be under the control of reason and religion. If our thoughts are wrong, our feelings will be wrong. Our thoughts and feelings combined make up the moral character. What does it mean to have our feelings under control by religion? So let's look at religion in the scriptures. James chapter 1, verse 27. Pure religion and undefiled before God and the Father is this, to visit the fatherless and the widows in their affliction and to keep himself unspotted from the world. Pure religion is visiting people in their religion. It's focusing on other people. One of the reasons why we have so much struggles in our thoughts and our feelings is that we're so much concerned with our own self. How this person has wronged me, or my problems, or have they not considered what I have been going through? Do they not know what I've been experiencing? This is the reason why often we can get so centered on ourselves that we may be tempted, it opens an effectual door to be tempted with our thoughts and feelings towards someone or a circumstance, and we're not focusing on others. One reason of so much despondency and depression is because we're so much centered on ourselves and we're not seeking to help and to bless one another. If we can cast our cares upon God, for He careth for you, then we can find a peace of mind as our mind is stayed on Christ and as we trust in Christ to work for others. And by working for others, we actually have a chemical in our minds. It's called oxytocin. Oxytocin is known as the love hormone. And by helping others, we get more of oxytocin, which helps us to strengthen our bones, and it helps us to have overall good health and boost our immune system. By working for others, we are able to, our health will even increase. Let's actually look at Isaiah 58. This is the work of the people. This is our work at the end of the world, Isaiah 58. If we can go there, we can go Isaiah 58, verse 6. This is present truth for our time. Is this not the fast that I have chosen, to loose the bands of wickedness, to undo the heavy burdens, and to let the oppressed go free, that ye break every yoke? Is it not to deal thy bread to the hungry, and that thou bring the poor that are cast out to thy house? When thou seest the naked, that thou cover him, and that thou hide not thyself from thine own flesh? Then shall thy light break forth as the morning, and thy health shall spring forth speedily, and thy righteousness shall go before thee, and the glory of the Lord shall be thy reward. If we want light in our dwelling and health to spring forth speedily, we need to be engaged in self-sacrificing love for others. By having outreach, by working for souls, laboring for others, we forget our own cares. We forget our own problems. And God has actually put chemicals in our body that will heal and work in our life and in our health to give us peace over our mental illness, to give us physical strength over our physical illness. God cares about everything, and we will find the greatest joy by perfect obedience, voluntarily being obedient to Christ. Now, another question that I've experienced is, like, what do we do when it's like we're seeing some tips and some principles how to overcome when we're tempted with these feelings, but what if I'm tempted to complain about someone or say something, or it's like, what do I do when I'm tempted to, and I'm going down this wrong train of thought? Philippians 4:8 gives us a very practical experience, very practical solution, steps to victory. Philippians 4:8. What do I do when I'm tempted to complain, to murmur, to evil speak, backbite, be a talebearer, busybody in other men's matters? Philippians 4:8, finally, brethren, whatsoever things are true, whatsoever things are honest, whatsoever things are just, whatsoever things are pure, whatsoever things are lovely, pay attention to this, whatsoever things are of good report, ask yourself, is this a good report? If there be any virtue, if there be any praise, is complaining of others praise? Is it the opposite of praise? Are we not to study the opposite traits of character? Think on these things, so out of the abundance of our heart, our mouth will speak. So when we're tempted to complain and to murmur or to evil speak, God's counsel is, if it's not a good report, don't say it. If no praise, don't say it. Which also means that when we're tempted to complain of what someone has said or done, praise something in that person's life or character. Cultivate thankfulness. Praise God for His wonderful love in giving Christ to die for us. It never pays to think of our grievances. God calls upon us to think of His mercy and His matchless love, that we may be inspired with praise. That's Ministry of Healing 492, and it's in your handouts. When we are tempted to complain, praise something about that person. And again, we may find it very difficult to find good things to point out in people that we are struggling to love. But by noticing that or seeking for helpful things in one's life and character, remember, by reason of use, we can have our senses exercised to discern between good and evil. The more we do it, the easier it will become, the less of a temptation it will be tomorrow. And it, one of our greatest weaknesses can be the strongest fortifications in our life. Now I love doing dishes. I used to hate it, but with what I've learned from the Word of God, I will gladly wipe the dishes and wash, and that is something when we're in group settings, it's That is something that I would be more inclined to do now to help lighten the load in general with the dishes, because God's word is practical and His grace is sufficient for us. And He can do that with any portion in our life. But we need to obey His counsel. Let's continue to read. Another thing is in Romans chapter 12. Romans 12, 17. We can continue to see principles on this manner. Romans chapter 12, verse 17. Again, we're looking at when we are struggling with these wrong habits towards a certain person or overcoming our thoughts and our feelings. The Bible says, "Recompense to no man evil for evil. Provide things honest in the sight of all men. If it be possible, as much as lieth in you, live peaceably with all men. Dearly beloved, avenge not yourselves, but rather give place unto wrath. For it is written, Vengeance is mine, I will repay, saith the Lord. Therefore, if thine enemy hunger, feed him. If he thirst, give him drink. For in so doing, thou shalt heap coals of fire on his head. Be not overcome with evil, but overcome evil with good." If we're tempted with evil, how do we overcome evil?
With good.
With good. By continually speaking evil or thinking evil thoughts, evil feelings, that's not going to overcome. Hatred, having hatred and unforgiveness and issues with others, it's like drinking poison and expecting the other person to die. Is that going to help the situation at all? What will help is by beholding the Lamb of God on the cross, you'll see the value of a soul. You will see how much worth Christ puts on their soul. You'll be inspired with a love and a strength to want to reflect Christ to them, to not allow the carnal man to come out and to retaliate, to recompense evil for evil, but by being a good example, you are glorifying God. This is our purpose for creation. Nowhere in the Bible does it say it's wrong for people to take advantage of us. Nowhere in the Bible does it say that if we are buffeted for our faults or for things that we have not done, then we shouldn't bear it patiently. This is acceptable to God. We are glorifying God in His character. How patient was Christ with you? While you were yet sinners, did Christ die for you? Yes, He did. We shouldn't wait for our enemies to change, but we should change because Christ wants us to change.
Amen.
But you know what happens if we scatter the seed of dissension and strife, when we give way to this wrath, to the carnal man, and we fall into this? I believe we all want genuinely the best for each other and ourselves. And many times, that's why the Bible rightfully represented sin as slavery and bondage, because we don't truly realize we are entangled in a trap, as a bird to the snare, and we see when many times we'll get caught up with, but there is a reaction for everything that happens. Let's go to Galatians 6:7. There's a great deception that's going on. Galatians 6:7. When the disciples asked Jesus on the Mount of Olives, "Lord, what shall be the sign of your coming and of the end of the world?" The very first words out of his mouth was, "Take heed that no man deceive you." Deception is one of the signs of the last days. There's a great deception that many of us are deceived in. Galatians 6:7, the Word of God says, "Be not deceived. God is not mocked, for whatsoever a man soweth, that shall he also reap." Ministry of Healing 492, evil speaking is a twofold curse, falling more heavily upon the speaker than upon the hearer. He who scatters the seeds of dissension and strife reaps in his own soul the deadly fruits. You're not going to expect to plant tomato seeds and expect lettuce to spring up. If you plant evil words, evil sentiments, and evil thoughts and feelings, and you give expression to these things, just because the devil's tempting you in your mind doesn't mean you have to speak those words to others and bring temptation on the hearers that are around you and are in your sphere of influence and atmosphere. But if you are like in the parable of Matthew 13, the sower went forth to sow, and that seed was the word of God, we can sow the very precious words of God that are able to save souls, save our souls, and help others. The best way to learn is to teach. And like the demoniacs, they never heard a sermon that fell from the lips of Christ. They didn't spend as much time with him as did the disciples. But Christ sent them as the first missionaries to their country. Though they didn't understand much, they can share what they knew. They can share their experience and their testimony. Talk about Christ and his wondrous love. When you are tempted to complain or to evil speak, know that you are sowing seeds. And even though you may overcome the sentiments that you're sharing, many times when we share, the hearers that we fall upon, they may never overcome. And they may be lost as a result of the one careless word that we have said, one discouraging word we said under temptation. We need to veil ourselves because this warfare is real. This game is real, and Christ and Satan is playing for keeps. We do not want to neglect the prayer, the study of the scriptures, and availing ourselves with song, which is a weapon. Let's go to Psalms 126, verse 5 and 6. I really like this verse because this shows the cure for depression. This shows the cure for sadness and grief. Do we want to know how to overcome sadness and grief? Do we want the steps of victory in this area in our life? Psalms 126 and verse 5. Let's actually begin in verse 4 because we're looking at captivity. The truth shall make you free. Studying the opposite traits of character. Psalms 126 verse 4. This whole chapter is a scripture song, friends. Turn again our captivity, O Lord, as the streams in the south. They that sow in what?
Tears
shall reap in what?
Joy.
He that goeth forth and weepeth, bearing what kind of seed?
Precious seed
shall doubtless come again with rejoicing, bringing his sheaves with him. The cure for sorrow and sadness and tears is sowing the precious seed of the Word of God. And it's not a man hath joy by the answer of his lips. It's not by speaking, complaining, criticizing, condemning those who are striving against sin, but it is through speaking of Christ, his strength, his grace, and the precious experiences that he has been giving to us. And by cultivating thankfulness, by cultivating being able to see good things and qualities in other people. This is the work that God has given to us. What we sow, we will reap. So let's sow the precious seed of the Word of God. Let's go to Mark chapter 8 and verse 34. Mark chapter 8, verse 34. Sometimes this can be a struggle. Christ never said that the Christian walk would be without struggle, but he did say that his grace is sufficient for thee. Mark chapter 8, verse 34. This is a subject that's dear to my heart. It's very personal to me. Mark 8, verse 34. And when he had called the people unto him, with his disciples also, he said unto them, Whosoever will come after me, let him deny himself, and take up his cross, and follow me. For whomsoever will save his life shall lose it, but whosoever shall lose his life for my sake and the gospel's, the same shall save it. For what shall it profit a man if he gain the whole world and lose his soul? Or what shall a man give in exchange for his soul? Ask yourself, is it worth it? What is your soul worth? Is it worth harboring hatred, harboring bad thoughts and feelings? Is it worth gaining financial security through forgery or lies, deceit? What does it profit if we gain the whole world and lose our soul? If we are to follow after Christ, he said, whosoever come after me, let him deny himself and take up his cross and follow me. I want to know, what is this cross? Christ said that we have a cross that we are to take up and to follow. Does it mean, I've heard a story of a man who built a cross and he starts walking around the town and he's like lugging this big heavy wooden structure. And he's like, yeah, I got to take up my cross and follow him. And he thinks that he's doing a good witness to people. But is this the cross that Christ was teaching that we are to deny ourselves and take up? Let's go to Luke 14, 26. Luke 14, 26. Can we be Christ's disciple without taking our cross? Or would there be a Christian without the cross?
No.
No, there wouldn't. Luke 14, 26. Notice what Christ says. If a man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children and brethren and sisters, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple. That's some strong words. And whosoever doth not bear his cross and come after me cannot be my disciple. If we do not take up our cross, we cannot be Christ's disciple. So wouldn't it behoove us, if we desire to be disciples, students in the school of Christ, to learn what is the cross in a practical sense? What is the cross in a personal level? What's the cross? This seems serious. We should be able to answer. When you look at the death and the resurrection of Christ, most of the Christian world will tell us that by Christ dying on Friday, he resting in the grave on Sabbath, and then resurrecting on Sunday, the first day of the week, by his death and resurrection, the Sabbath was then changed from Saturday to Sunday, and we now we go to church on Sunday because Christ has resurrected on Sunday. And this is what many sincere Christians believe and teach. But nowhere in the Bible do we see that the Sabbath was changed from Saturday to Sunday because of the resurrection. In fact, we have something else that the Bible very clearly tells us is a memorial of the resurrection. Let's go to Romans chapter 6, and it also tells us about the cross. Romans chapter 6 and verse 1. Christ, as his manner was, he preached in the synagogues every Sabbath day. Paul preached on Sabbath. All the disciples preached on Sabbath. And for 300 years after the resurrection, God's people, his early Christians, were going to church on Sabbath. Here we see the resurrection is actually a symbol identified in Romans 6, verse 1. The Bible says, we're looking at what is the cross and what has God given to us as a symbol of the resurrection. What shall we say then? Shall we continue in sin that grace may abound? God forbid. How shall we that are dead to sin live any longer therein? Know ye not that so many of us as were baptized into Christ were baptized into his what?
Death.
His death. And his death was the death of the cross, right? Therefore we are buried with him by baptism into death, that like as Christ was raised up from the dead by the glory of the Father, even so we also should walk in newness of life. For if we have been planted together in the likeness of his death, we shall be also in the likeness of his resurrection. Knowing this, that our old man is what?
Crucified.
We're getting a better understanding of what the Christian's cross is. Our old man is crucified with him, that the body of sin might be destroyed, that henceforth we should not serve sin, for he that is dead is freed from sin. Any of you who are considering baptism at this camp meeting, I know last year there were many people who were touched by the Holy Spirit of God, and they made commitments for eternity. Baptism was given to us to represent as Christ, holy, undefiled, and sinless, was treated as a malefactor, completely as a lamb without blemish. He died the death that we deserve. He was treated as we deserve. That as he was able to sacrifice himself because of the great love that he has for us and his resurrection, not only his death, but his life is what's being represented as baptism. Being dead to our old self, our old man, the natural inclinations of our hearts, our old thoughts and feelings, that our hearts is just so deceitfully, desperately wicked above all things. Who can know it? Putting that in the past, my unwillingness to do dishes, that needs to be crucified. And the baptism alone is really an ordinance to represent our public commitment to Christ. Nothing in of the water is going to give us the strength. The water isn't going to change us. It's by availing ourselves with the whole armor of God every day is what will give us the strength in life. But this is what we are committing to with baptism. And we're seeing that the cross, the Christian's cross that we are to bear. Let's go to Galatians chapter 5. Galatians 5:19. We'll understand, let's look a little bit more into the works of the flesh. By doing so, we'll understand the old man who needs to be crucified with Christ. Galatians 5:19. I believe this verse especially, it just really speaks to me and it makes me realize what is the cross of a Christian. Galatians 5:19. Now the works of the flesh are manifest, which are these: adultery, fornication, uncleanliness, lasciviousness, idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, emulations, which is competition, wrath, strife, seditions, heresies, envyings, murders, drunkenness, revelings, and such like, of which I tell you before, as I have also told you in times past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. Likewise, Christ said, if you don't take up your cross, you cannot be my disciple. But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. Right here, Galatians 5:24 identifies what the cross is. Crucifying the flesh with the affections and the lust. Here's a quote from Lift Him Up. It's a beautiful devotional. 2:42. The cross is that which crosses the natural affections and the will. The cross is that which crosses the natural affection and the will. Anything in our life that we are naturally, carnally inclined to do, but we recognize by principle or by the Word of God, that God says, no, I have a more excellent way. I have something better for you. And no good thing will God uphold from those who walk uprightly. But anything where there is a way that seemeth right to a man, but the end thereof are the way of death. In our own, in our best thinking, it has gotten us into a lot of trouble. But through studying the Word of God, we can find the plans, the steps of victory, even the plan of salvation. And that is the cross. Part of the Spirit, the fruit of the Spirit, is temperance. It is being temperate in seeing, in hearing, in sleeping and working, in eating. It's temperance. True temperance teaches us to abstain entirely from all things that are harmful and to use judiciously or moderately that which is good. This is the fruit of the Spirit. But let's look at temperance a little bit more. Could temperance be a cross? Let's go to Philippians 3, verse 18. Philippians 3, 18. And as I mentioned before, we're not going to go through everything. But there are a few things I wanted to point out. Philippians 3:18. For many walk, of whom I have told you often, and now tell you even weeping, that they are the enemies of the cross of Christ. God forbid that we become the enemies of the cross of Christ, whose end is destruction, whose God is their what?
Belly.
And whose glory is in their shame, whose mind earthly things. For our conversation is in heaven, from whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ. We may say that I love Christ. I shed tears when I behold the scenes of Calvary. And we may talk of Christ, we may preach Christ, we may speak Christ, but when Christ asks, are you willing to die for me? Are you willing to take up your cross for me? And we realize, oh, the cross, you mean my dying to my belly? Not gratifying my unsanctified appetites? You mean change my diet? Clean out my refrigerator? Have a change in life? This is a hard saying. I don't know if I can quite go that far. We don't realize that sacrifice, the denial of appetite, the denial of ourself, is the cross. And we just denied it. And we are the enemies of the cross of Christ. When our God is our belly, of whom we pledge our allegiance and obedience, this is the denying our cross, and this is choosing another Savior who cannot save. We can further see in Romans 16:17. We can read Romans 16:17. The Bible says, now I beseech you, brethren, mark them which cause divisions. Remember when we were studying about the dissension and the divisions and the evil speaking, the evil thoughts, this is what it's connected with. Mark them which cause divisions and offenses contrary to the doctrine which ye have learned, and avoid them. For they that are such serve not our Lord Jesus Christ, but their own belly, and by good words and fair speeches deceive the hearts of the simple. It's beautiful because through the provisions of Christ and His sacrifice, He has allowed us to eat all things that we have for nourishment and strength. All good things come from God. James chapter 1 says, every good and perfect gift is from above and cometh down from the Father of lights. In giving us His Son, the Father exhausted all of heaven's resources for you. Every time there was food on our table, every loaf of bread, it is stamped with the cross. Amen. The food that we eat, it's a cross. Health reform is a cross that Christ asks us to bear. But though it requires a sacrifice of our selfish inclination and desire, is it not true, in the contrary, that by eating, like drinking alcohol, is there not a sacrifice associated with killing our brain cell, damaging our liver, and dampening our experience in life in general, and our ability to live and move in our body, which God has fearfully and wonderfully created? That is a sacrifice as well, no matter how you look at it. If you disobey God, that's a cross, and you're going to sacrifice somehow. If you obey God, you're going to sacrifice that which was really never good for you or helpful, and you will gain the peace and trust in knowing your Creator and your purpose of creation. And this is what God would have for us. Health reform is a cross, and it's one of the things that God has given to us. And I would like to read one more quote, if we can. Let's go to the very end. Something that really spoke to me. I thought it was really amazing on the very last page, where it says, free will offering is a cross. This comes from Historical Sketches, 293, paragraph 3. It says, let the members of the church now put away their pride and lay off their ornaments. Each should keep a missionary box at hand and drop into it every penny he is tempted to waste in self-indulgence. But something more must be done than merely to dispense with superfluities. Self-denial must be practiced. Some of our comfortable and desirable things must be sacrificed. The preachers must sharpen up their message. Notice, preachers need to sharpen their message, not merely assailing self-indulgence, pride and dress, but presenting Jesus, His life of self-denial and sacrifice. Let love, piety, and faith be cherished in the heart, and the precious fruits will appear in the life. We have a promise. The precious fruits will appear in our life as we behold Christ and His self-denial and His self-sacrificing love. It's one thing to preach and condemn about intemperate eating and pride in dress, but if you really want to sharpen your message, present Jesus and His self-sacrificing example. And like I was sharing before, when you study the opposite traits of character, that is what is going to bring our experience from being confessing again and again, sinning and repenting, sinning and repenting, sinning and repenting, and finding the steps to victory. You will find the steps to victory as you study the opposite traits of character, and as you look to Christ, who is the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before Him endured the cross, despising the shame. That joy was seeing you come into the kingdom as a result of his sacrifice. Will we accept the cross of Christ today and cheerfully bow to lift it? This is my prayer. And if it's yours as well, then I'd like to invite each of us, all who are able or willing, if we can kneel for a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you so much for giving us your Son. As we have seen that you have loved us with an everlasting love, and it is with loving kindness that you draw us, I pray, it is my prayer that as we go throughout the week and throughout our daily lives, that we may behold this loving kindness to ever keep before us the self-renouncing love of Christ and the life that he walked on this earth. Help us to be filled and inspired with awe as we look to our example, who was wholly undefiled and sinless, but he was not ashamed to call us brethren, and forever have linked himself with humanity with ties that shall never be broken. In Christ, we are able to pray to you and be sons and daughters of God. We pray that you will, Lord, we believe, help thou our unbelief in these promises. Please improve our memory that we may have a supernatural ability to memorize these promises that you have given to us, to fortify our minds when the tempter comes. Help us to memorize the hymns, the scripture songs, the spiritual songs, the melodies that you have given to us, that we may fight off the evil spirits. This spiritual war is so real, and in many sense, it is more real, and the results are more everlasting than even earthly battles that are physically fought in this world below. Help us to see this week our need of turning to you and availing ourselves with your provisions. We pray this in Christ's precious name. Amen.